Well, this is certainly one of the only times to my memory that I've been invited to a performance, not to sing or dance, but simply to talk. Who knows what I might say? And I can't see the audience out there, but I'm told that you're watching from at home, or so says this cameraman here. From at home in your living rooms. Bonjour to you, or bonsoir, wherever you are. And I certainly hope you're sitting next to someone you love. And perhaps something I say will make you smile. But if I do turn out to be quite boring, that's all right, because we're going to be listening to some music by the fabulous composer, Miss Valerie Coleman. Isn't that right, Mr. Cameraman? Yes, I'm very excited. And to hear the St. Luke's Chamber Ensemble. It isn't every day that someone has written a suite of music about me. It's plenty of people have written music for me to perform. J'ai deux amours, of course, and many others. But about me, for me to listen to? That is quite an honor. Anyway, enough of me. Let's hear some music. Play. Old St. Louis, oui, c'est St. Louis, where I was born, of course. To hear music like that, I feel 10 years old again. The trembling vibrato, the low slides and moaning bends, the growling brass. It's like an old St. Louis street band, but with an oboe. What a delight! I just want to get up and dance. I don't know how anyone could sit still. Yes, my mother was a dancer. And my father, well, I suppose he was a musician, but I never met him, so I don't suppose I owe him much of anything, do you? But my mother and stepfather and aunt and siblings and I, we took good care of each other. I used to love to make my siblings laugh and laugh. Yes, they used to call me Tumpy. I suppose I used to be plump, but hard to imagine now. I used to put on these little performances, and eventually I joined the Jones Family Band, and we performed right on 22nd Street. Yes, in downtown St. Louis. Oh, no, not that. They didn't let us perform on any stage. We performed outside the Booker T. Washington Vaudeville Theater. That's where the theater manager first noticed me and invited me to join the Dixie Steppers. That changed my life. It was my ticket out. Yes. Yes, I ran away. Not from my mother, no. No, I love my family very much, but I couldn't stay in St. Louis. Or in the United States. Because of the terror of discrimination. That horrible beast that paralyzes the very soul and body. Those in this audience that have felt the pain of discrimination know what I'm talking about. And those that understand human beings understand what I'm talking about, too. I was just a little girl, and I still remember the terror of the East St. Louis race riots. I was just a tiny thing, but I still remember the glow of the burning Negro homes. We children huddled together and the screams of Negro families running across the bridge. For years, the city of St. Louis represented to me a city of fear, humiliation, misery, and terror. A city where, in the eyes of the white man, the Negro had better know his place and stay in it. So I ran and ran and ran. I wanted to find freedom of soul and spirit, and I wanted to get away from those who believed in cruelty, so I went away. I tried to marry my way out at first. That didn't take me very far. I had to find my own way out. I danced my way out. Vaudeville, do you know? Oh, you've never seen vaudeville? Of course, you're much too young. Where have the years gone? I really am going on rambling, aren't I? Please, if you won't let me sing, let's hear some more music.
Thank you.
Tell if Miss Coleman wants to make me laugh or cry with these remembrances. Of course, it takes me right back to Paris, 1925, backstage at the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées avec Le Revue Nègre. The oboe, the way she quivered and sparkled like that, just like the butterflies in my stomach before the curtain would rise. Yes, I was nervous before every show. Well, we would have two shows a night, sometimes three. You'd just catch your breath before the curtain would rise again. The little piccolo, she reminds me of myself. A tiny thing amongst all the big wind instruments, but her voice is unmistakable. She will be heard. I was just 19 when I arrived. A very frightened little girl. Yes, frightened. I was absolutely unknown when I was here in America. I wasn't anybody. Josephine Baker was just the girl who left St. Louis to come to Europe to find freedom. In New York, yes, I was in Shuffle Along and Chocolate Dandies. Blake and Miller were kind enough to me, but I wasn't anybody. I was just a chorus girl. The highest paid chorus girl in America. Who said that? I don't know anything about that. I was just the funny girl at the end of the line. I was shorter and darker skinned than all the other girls, so I had to have something to make me stand out. The crossed eyes and high kicks and all that. Caroline Dudley came to the Plantation Club and asked me if I would come with her to Paris to star in La Revue Nègre. And of course I said yes. Well, I wanted to go to Paris because, well, everyone knows Paris. It is the city of art. It was marvelous, better than I could have imagined. Back then, there was that jungle fever all over Paris. The rhythms of the music, the tempo of the dances shifted overnight. Everything classical and European was out, and everything African and black and colored was in. I suppose it sounds crass to say it today, but that's absolutely how it was. And overnight, I was the star, doing back bends and high kicks in nothing but an ostrich feather and a banana skirt. What do you think? Hearts and hands were all a flutter, trying to keep pace. And not just the men. I definitely wanted to seduce the whole capital, and at one point perhaps I did. Young people have to live their lives. I did mine, and I suppose you too. And I think, why not? Well, for the first time, I was staying in high-class hotels and eating at whatever restaurant I wanted. Never mind that I was a colored woman. Nobody cared about such things in Paris. Do you know why I like Frenchmen? Because even when they insult you, they do it so nicely. The French press, they called me the Black Venus. The American press, so they called me a bucktooth Negro wench. And so many other hurtful names. They beat me, you know. Not with clubs. I mean, I've seen that too. But they beat me with their writings, with their words. Outright racism is what it was. I didn't know I could be treated with dignity by white people until I came to Paris. The land of true democracy, freedom, fraternity, equality, mal français. You really shouldn't let me ramble on, or I'll never stop, because I'm a woman and blah, 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 and all that. I want to hear where in my past this music will take me next. Please play some more. Morocco. Oh, that melody. I could get lost in those repetitions. Quite seductive, wouldn't you agree? I didn't expect to go there tonight. I didn't expect to go there at all. There was an invitation I couldn't refuse. So it goes with seduction. Yes, I was in Casablanca for 6 months during the war. Well, the press thought I was there recovering from an illness. Actually, they thought I'd died. Langston Hughes wrote my obituary in the United States, and I had to come forward and tell the world I was much too busy to be dead. I was quite ill. That part is true. And also, I suppose I can tell you now, after all these years, I was there with dear Jacques, Monsieur Abti, to establish a liaison and transmission center with the British intelligence, and to coordinate passports for Eastern European Jews who were in exile in South America. Yes, I was a spy. It's true. Well, because Dear Jacques asked me, and I said yes. He could be quite persuasive. But of course I joined La Résistance. France made me who I am. The Parisians gave me their hearts, and I was ready to give them my life. And the thing that drove me, as much did my patriotism, was my hatred of discrimination in any form. And the Nazis were the worst version of it I'd ever seen. I was quite a good spy, if you must know. I'd have dinner with German operatives, and no one suspected I was scribbling notes on my napkins and pinning them to my lingerie when I went to the powder room. Of course, my notes would have been quite compromising had they been discovered, but who would dare strip Josephine Baker to the skin? When people ask me for my papers, they generally mean my autograph. Exciting? At times, yes. But you must remember, we were in exile from the German invasion. I had to flee my home, Les Milandes, packing what I could, driving through the night. My animals, yes, I did bring them. But not the cheetah, no. Miss Chiquita had died years before. I brought my Great Danes and Binky, the little spider monkey, and perhaps some mice, too. I don't quite remember. They were my darling babies before I actually had children. I couldn't leave them. Why did I bring the gold piano? Well, what was I to do? Leave it to be melted down for cash and spent on Nazi bombs? Mon Dieu. Yes, performance is a part of my service, too. I brought what comfort I could to all the Allied troops, the French and the American. I have love for the United States in my own way. It's difficult to love a place that hurts you. And friends, I do not lie when I tell you I could not walk into a hotel in America and get a cup of coffee. And that made me mad. And when I get mad, well, I open my big mouth. And then watch out. When Josephine opens her mouth, you hear it all over the world. I was hounded by American intelligence agencies. The FBI and Mr. Hoover himself had it out for me. They were mad because I told the truth. Well, this America belongs to black people as much as it does to any of the white race. In some ways, even more so, because we gave the sweat of our brow and our blood in slavery so that some parts of this America could become prosperous and recognized throughout the world. This land belongs to us. And other minorities, too, as much as to anyone else, apart from the real Americans, who are the native peoples. I suppose you think I'm going on rambling again? Well, let me tell you something. I have lived a long while, and I have come a long way. And they will say, Josephine Baker, she was a devil. And you know what? They are right. I was, too. I was a devil in other countries, and I was a little devil in America, too. Young people today, I have heard you calling out Black Lives Matter. It's a phrase that shouldn't be controversial, but it is still after all these years. And they will call you a devil for saying it. But don't let them tell you to be quiet. Scream it out, louder still. And friends, when you scream, you will be heard. You will be heard now. Discrimination makes me angry. And you understand? And music is the salve. Let's hear another piece. Let's enjoy some music together.
Thank you.
Now, Miss Coleman, I do think she wants me to cry with such rich harmonies. When have I heard a bassoon with such longing? But to cry is a good thing. To feel, to love. What else is there? Mr. Cameraman, where is your home? The place you feel most right in the world? For me, c'est le Maland. Village to the world, capital of universal fraternity. I started my rainbow tribe vision there. My children adopted all from different nationalities. I wanted to do something to prove to the world that we could live together in harmony if we wanted to. And we did, my family and I. It was a model for the world. And it was our home. And it was auctioned off in pieces. They cut off my electricity. I'm sorry. I'm a little, Thanks to a plea from a dear friend, Bridget Bardot, the world came forward to help me. Dignitaries, celebrities, loving children from all over Europe, donated to my cause, but it wasn't enough. Let's talk about something else. My children, now you're touching me right in my heart. When we're talking about children, I'm very happy. And when we're talking about my children, I'm even more happy. I have 12, 10 boys and 2 girls. And I think perhaps all parents think their children are wonderful, but mine are, they're more than wonderful. They're so human and understanding. And they love people in general. I've had to work very hard and think about their futures. And I haven't had time to talk to them. Not nearly enough. But I'm always thinking of them. I suppose I'm lucky to have had such a long career. Well, some people can't perform after they get to a certain age, but I've never stopped. I'm lucky, blessed. J'ai deux amours, of course, emblematique. How many times have I performed it? Well, how could I count? Infini. Gio and Henri, they wrote a perfect song for me, and Vincent, a wonderful composer. The Frenchman, like I told you. Yes, it means my two loves. I've had many loves. Gentlemen and ladies, and some very famous, and some I've kept just for me. I don't know that any has compared to the love I have for Paris. I'm grateful for the reminiscence you've taken me on tonight. I'm grateful to Miss Coleman and the Orchestra of St. Luke's. I was afraid that you'd forgot me, that the audience had forgot me, that there are things to do and other performers, and I thought maybe I didn't have my place, but to know that my life still inspires such music, it's... You've given me a gift. I thank you. Thank you.